Good evening, dear past presidents, council members, members, guests and ISL staff. You all are warmly welcome for the engineer BD Rampala Memorial Oration. Please kindly rise to welcome the presidential procession. Please remain standing. Now it's the time to light the oil lamp. I cordially invite Engineer J. Meegoda, immediate past president, in the absence of President Madam Ratnayaka. Past presidents, Engineer B.R. Fernando, Engineer Priyaldi Silva, and Engineer Dr. Ranasingha, Ananda Ranasingha. Engineer Dhammika Jayasundara, guest speaker, representatives of late Engineer Rampala, Mr. Malinda Vijayvikrama, great grandson of Engineer Rampala, Ms. Amasa Panagoda, great granddaughter of Engineer Rampala, Engineer Asel Patiratna, Chairman Mechanical Engineering Sectional Committee. Please remain standing. Now I kindly invite Engineer Meegoda to garland the photograph of Engineer B.D. Rampala. Thank you very much. Please be seated. I kindly invite Engineer Meegoda, Engineer Jayasurya, Engineer Patiratna on stage. Now it's the time for the welcome address. I cordially invite Engineer Jayavilal Meegoda into this podium.
Hi, Bohan. Good evening. Engineer Dhammika Jayasundara, our speaker today. Relatives of late Engineer B.D. Rampala, past presidents, council members, members, distinguished invitees, ladies and gentlemen. As the immediate past president of the Institution of Engineers Sri Lanka, I would like to extend a very warm welcome to all of you present here today, and especially our speaker, Engineer Dhammika Jayasundara, representatives of the family of late Engineer B.D. Rampala, and all other guests. The ISL, as the apex body for the engineering profession of Sri Lanka, commemorates the birth anniversaries of engineering greats the country has produced. And Engineer B.D. Rampala's name is etched in its engineering history. The Institution of Engineers Sri Lanka has the added honor of having Engineer Rampala as its president during 1957-58 session. Born on 14th November 1910, Don Rampala, popularly known as B.D. Rampala, received his education at the Ananda College. After completing his engineering apprenticeship in 1934 at Colombo University College, he joined Ratmalana Railway Mechanical Engineering Department of the then Ceylon Government Railway. In 1949, he was appointed as Chief Mechanical Engineer of the Railways, the first Sri Lankan engineer at that post. During his time at this post, Engineer Rampala noticed many major railways around the world were upgrading from steam locomotives to diesel. He made this proposal to dieselize the Sri Lankan railways, and in 1953, the first batch of diesel locomotives arrived from Brush Bagnall of the United Kingdom. When the locomotives started faulting, Engineer Rampala made modifications to them. When inspected by the British builders, his modifications were approved and not challenged against their original design. He submitted a paper on his observations to the Institution of Locomotive Engineers in London, which gave him full praise. In 1955, Engineer Rampala was appointed as the General Manager of the Sri Lanka Railways, the short period within which he transformed the railways in the country to suit the times is etched in the history of local railways as its golden era. The dieselization of locomotives, introduction of centrally controlled electronic color light signal system, launching of express train services under different names, providing better station facilities, etc., were all done in that period. In short, he did what was necessary in his time so that the country and its people enjoyed the fruits of global development in this field of that time. In 1956, the Institution of Locomotive Engineers in London recognized Engineer Rampala as the best diesel engineer in Asia. Analysts have shown the economics of transforming the system from diesel locomotives to electric locomotives by way of the savings to be had from the fuel and maintenance costs alone. Benefits to be had from electrification would set off the new investments necessary, not to mention the additional benefits of reduced pollution, passenger comfort, and the more productive use of human resources to reduce travel time. More importantly, the reduced travel time and improved passenger comfort could increase the commuter percentages of the railways, helping reduce the road transport congestion to a great extent. In 1997-98, the ISL submitted its recommendations for electrification of at least the most used sections in the suburb of the country's railways. Subsequently, the Institution of Engineers Sri Lanka submitted a new proposal in August 2008 for electrification of railways between Panaduru and Veyangoda. The efforts of the ISL has finally borne fruit is evident in that electrification of railways has been given due place within the current development plans of the country, with necessary funds being secured through the Asian Development Bank. It is in this background the ISL invited Engineer Dhammika Jayasundara to deliver today's memorial oration on another golden era for Sri Lanka Railways, commemorating the 107th birth anniversary of late Engineer B.D. Rampala. Engineer Dhammika Jayasundara has 17 years of experience in Sri Lanka Railways, and for the last 3 years he has been in charge of Sri Lanka Railway Signal Sub-Department. He possesses B.Sc. honours in Electrical Engineering from University of Moratuwa and a Postgraduate Diploma in E-Governance from University of Sri Jayawardanapura. In addition, he is a member of Institution of Engineers Sri Lanka and the Institute of Railway Signal Engineers UK. So over to you, Engineer Jayasundara.
Good evening, everybody. I think today is a great privilege for me to do this Rampala oration in front of such a distinguished gathering. So I consider this a great honor. And in my presentation, considering the participants here, I'm not going to tell you anything new actually. I can't tell you anything new. What I'm trying to do today is remind you a few things you may have forgotten, or just encourage you to look at things in a different way. It was Isaac Newton who said, "I was able to look further ahead by standing on the shoulders of the giants. In the similar way, if you can learn from railway business giants like Mr. B.D. Rampala, and we can learn about railway and we can plan to usher another golden era for Sri Lanka Railway. So, when in my presentation, I have divided into three parts. First part, I'm going to talk about the history of the railway, how we came into current situation, and then some details about current situation, and thereafter, what we have to do in order to have a better success in future. So, in this first slide, what you can see is this is the start of the railway. Initially, before 1825, there have been railways, but they have been mainly serving coal mines. To bring out the coal from the mine, they have used rails. But in 1825, first passenger railway line was built in between Darlington and Stockton. And this was done by Mr. George Stephenson. Stephenson is a pioneer in railway business. This 40 kilometer line from Darlington to Stockton was made using 1435 millimeter gauge. That's now recognized as standard gauge that has been used throughout the world. Actually, 60% of the railway tracks in the world are using the standard gauge. But if you consider Sri Lankan situation, we are using Indian broad gauge, that is 1676 millimeter gauge. That's selected by the British for Sri Lanka, India and Pakistan and Bangladesh. For this first journey, the locomotive used was called locomotion number 1, and that was constructed, built at the company owned by Robert Stephenson, that's the son of Mr. George Stephenson. And after construction of this line in 1825, Mr. George Stephenson, he got involved with the construction of first intercity line, that's between Manchester and Liverpool, 97 kilometer line. He got involved with that construction. And for that line also, the steam engine named Rocket was selected. That was selected after they have a race to select which engine should be used for that line. The engine constructed by Robert and George Stephenson was used for that line. So, while those things happening in Great Britain, in Sri Lanka, many changes were happening. With the fall of Candian Kingdom in 1815, British planters, they came to Sri Lanka and they started cultivating coffee, and they are after tea, I think, and rubber and all that throughout the country. So those planters, they need to transport their crops from hill country to the Colombo Harbour. For that, they got those bullock carts. That was not sufficient. So they started demanding construction of a railway line from Candy to Colombo. Initially, in 1845, they started a private company, Ceylon Railway Company, for that purpose. And initially, they thought the cost of this construction would be 850,000 sterling pounds. But after they did a detailed feasibility study, they found that amount is totally inadequate. Therefore, they couldn't proceed, and that work was taken over by the government. So, in 1858, government started Ceylon Government Railway, and Ceylon Government Railway was entrusted with constructing railway line initially from Colombo to Kandy. So in 1864, CGR constructed first railway line from Colombo to Ambepoosa, 54 kilometer line, and it was declared open in 1864. After 10 years, in 1874, that line was extended to Kandy, and there onward, I think it reached Nanuya by 1885. That's how railway line came to Sri Lanka. It came to Sri Lanka because there was a genuine business demand, economic demand for train service. It didn't happen the way that after construction of the railway, the business requirement arose. It happened such a way that due to the business requirement, the British, they built that railway line into the hill country. So when trains arrive in Sri Lanka, they got a very high competitive advantage, because main competitor you can clearly see is the bullock car. You can see the difference, the height difference also there. I think the service level also have got the same difference. You can see the railway tracks nicely laid with enough ballast, very nice looking, and you can see the bullock carts going on the gravel road nearby. So after arrival in Sri Lanka, the railway was able to create a monopoly unchallenged by whatever transport means available at that time. These are the other means of transportation available at that time. This is the Hamilton Canal, you got the barges, and here you can see the this Haputale Pass. Those bullock carts, they are resting after climbing this pass. So with this kind of competition, railway got the absolute control of the transport business. So wherever transport railway line extended, the progress followed. See, here you can see even the town center, you can see it's a Colombo, and there's another town center. The king of the road was bullock carts. So that's the competition railway has to fend off at that time. But with the increase of the expansion of the roadway network and increasing availability of road vehicles, the railway came under attack. I mean, they have to face the competition. Initially, if you consider British Railway, it was privately owned, but after the Second World War, the railway operation was taken over by the government, British government. That's because after the Second World War, the railway lines were badly battered. In order to sustain them, British government took over the operation of railway lines. But by 1950, they started facing competition from the road network. So in order to face that competition, initially they come up with a modernization plan, but it didn't yield necessary results. So then they put a new chairman for the British Railway Board, Mr. Richard Beeching. So Richard Beeching, he made the analysis of the situation British Railway at that time, and found out that 1/3 of the route kilometers carried just 1% of the passengers, and 50% of the stations contributed only for the 2% of the passenger revenue. Because with the road transport competition, railway start losing its monopoly, and it need to find a new areas of business. So as a result of that, they start gradually losing the market. So under this Beeching Acts, low demand lines and stations removed to make a business sustainable. So I put this example from British experience. That's because railway at the initiation got the monopoly. With the road network competition, it need to adjust. Similarly, if you consider Japanese National Railway, it was also taken over by the government, I think little before the Second World War, in preparation for the Second World War maybe. And in 1950, Japanese National Railway was enjoying 50% of the transport market in passenger and goods transportation. Then by 1970, Japanese National Railway started losing way with the competition from road and air travel. And also during that time, they keep on constructing unprofitable railway lines due to political patronage, and that made the situation even worse. And also they couldn't close it because political forces behind it didn't allow it. So therefore, by 1987, Japanese National JNR has accumulated 37 trillion yen long-term debt. So therefore, Japanese government took action to privatize this. They broke Japanese National Railway into 6 parts for passenger transportation and another unit for freight transportation throughout the Japan. The out of those JR companies, those companies which are running Shinkansen, bullet train and urban commuter services, and with real estate business activity, started making profits. But still, the JR Hokkaido, which is providing services for the rural area, is still in red due to low demand lines they have to maintain. So I think when you put this situation context, the local situation and the situation experienced by wealthy countries like Japan and Great Britain,
we have to understand the situation faced in Sri Lanka. Mr. B.D. Rampala, he became General Manager of Sri Lanka Railways in 1955, and he joined Sri Lanka Railway in 1939 as a mechanical engineer, then got promoted as a Chief Engineer Mechanical in 1949, and then he became General Manager in 1955. So at the time Mr. B.D. Rampala took the reign of the railway, the change was already happening. So being a visionary, he understood the situation. So I got this part from his forward he has written to the Centenary Magazine of the Railway in 1964. In this he says, one day archaeologists would unearth and exhibit steam locomotive as a primitive transport engine used by human beings in the less developed age. What mode of transport will be in use then cannot even be visualized today. The possibility of trains running even without touching ground but keeping to a pre-selected path remotely controlled is almost here today. The feasibility of such devices for day-to-day transport is dependent not on their availability as a feat of engineering but on their economic value. Even in 1964, Mr. B.D. Rampala understood the transportation should depend upon its economic value. But therefore, we can learn a lot from his vision here, because only if there is a necessity, we can sustain a system. So in order to meet that competition from the road vehicles, the railway started fighting back. They didn't give up. They fought really hard to maintain the market share of the railway. They introduced long-distance passenger trains. That's why we got Uttaratamanike, Yaldevi and Rohanukumari. Those are transport service products to bring people back to the railway, because railway got one disadvantage. That's because if someone want to make a journey or transport goods, if you got a road vehicle, from the start to end you can transport your goods. But if you consider railway, if the production facility is not very much closer to the railway line, they need to bring that goods to the railway and transport by the railway, and at the end also again they have to transport to the final destination. So railway is having the disadvantage. So with the availability of road vehicles and the road expansion of road network, railway is finding it really difficult to compete. So what they did first is the introduction of long distance passenger trains. Then also they did lot of marketing and advertising. That's something we have never heard in today's, we have never heard today. But at that time they did a really hard marketing and advertising using even the radio and pamphlets and advertising. And also they, in the policy level also, they got policies not to give permits for operation of lorries for areas served by the railway. And also at that time, using policies, they didn't allow buses to serve areas served by the railway, especially long distance buses. It was not allowed that time in order to give railway a free hand. And also by 1958, they start providing bus connections at the station. It's still not a new thing. We are still talking about having a transfer at the station. It was starting in 1958. And also they started railhead distribution at Chilau, Matra and Nanue like places. Railhead mean, now for example if you get Nanuaya, railway got collection centers from nearby places. So all those goods that need to be transferred railway are collected at those collection points and they were brought to Nanuaya and then they transported throughout the country. So this is a very good example how they approach this competition of the road network and the road vehicles. You can see the colorful picture here. It gives a picture of a lady and her daughter, and also having the signals, they have shown this maybe valuables in her bag, traveling by the railway. And through the window you can see the beautiful scenery. So then an article, this one says the safe railway. So you can travel comfortably and safe by railway. And you can see the map of Sri Lanka with the railway lines clearly marked. And for the start of those long distance passenger services, Uttaratamanike, Yaldevi, Rohanukumari, they have also given those pamphlets. So you can see in Sinhala and English, in both languages they have published it. And there is subtle use of marketing. You can see the figures they have used. Even today, I think marketers can be happy about this kind of marketing. Very simple, but very, very effective. So they have put lot of thought into this advertising campaign. All those things has been done to retain the railway's market share. It didn't stop here. Now you can see a picture here. I think it's clear. I hope it's clear. You can see railway lorries. Those are owned by railway to transport goods, to collect goods to be transported for the railheads. Oh, now, and also they got, this is a Columbia Yard. If you have seen Columbia Yard today and compare it to the activities that happened during 1950s, you can see the difference. Today yard is generally not even earning money for the railway. And if you consider the one perch of land there is about 17 million. So are we putting that land into proper use? At that time, 1950, they are far ahead of us. So they got collection and delivery services in Colombo and Kandy area. So door-to-day delivery, they will collect the goods and transport it to the destination and bring it to your doorstep. And storage facilities were given at Colombo and Kandy for good transporters. If you are transporting goods by the railway, then railway is giving you storage facility. That's an incentive for businessmen to use railway service. And also giving reduced rate for the large consignment of goods. That way attract more business to the railway. And they even introduce safe lock transport for valuable cargo with special vacuum locks. So that means that if you are transporting valuable cargo, they will be safely locked. And those wagons cannot be opened without the consent of the train driver. So they went up to that extent to retain the railway business. But at that time, everything was changing. Socio-economic scenario in this country was changing. We got our first woman prime minister. And the villages also, they are getting better connection to the road network. And also, private vehicles are becoming more and more available. Now you can see the town center. In the town center still you can see the bullock carts in 1960s, but you can clearly see cars, lorries and buses. So this is the competition that eventually resulted in reducing market share of transportation of the railway. I think that's a historical thing that happened, because in 1825, in 1850, there was no competition. So railway was able to get the monopoly, but by 1950, they are no longer enjoying that monopoly, though they have to adapt. So that's why under Mr. Rampala, the railway came up with so many transport products to meet that competition. I think what I have to admit, even today we are discussing those things at our forums, whether we should do it or whether we should do that to revive the railway. But it seems most of the things we are still thinking about has been already attempted by Mr. Rampala and railway people at that time. So it was Lord Buddha who said, the change is the only certain thing in this world. So change is the only certain thing. So any business organization created by humans cannot expect to survive forever without adapting to the change. Same applies to the railway. And dinosaurs, they roamed the earth for hundreds of millions of years, and they were the rulers of the earth. They got the might, no one was there to challenge them. But suddenly they all disappeared from the surface of the earth. That's because they could not adapt to the changing environment. The same applies to any business organization. According to Peter Drucker, he says, the business organization which has outlived its objectives is worse than business organization which is having no objective, because it's the very same objectives and strategies that allowed those organizations to become the market leaders, to create monopolies, is no longer valid today. If those organizations are not willing to give up those all objectives and adapt to the new environment, they are not going to survive. In such a situations, organizations need to do SWOT analysis. That means they need to find out what are the strengths of the organization, what are the weaknesses of the organization, And at the same time, they need to find out in the external environment what are the opportunities, what are the threats. Only by analyzing those things, organizations can adapt to the changing environment. The similar way, I think in the today railways in crossroads, it need to find what are its strengths, what are its weaknesses, and what are the opportunities and threats in the external environment. If you consider railway today, it got track length of 1,465 and it got a workforce of 14,865. That means 10 people for every kilometer. And if you are going to see the performance parameters of the railway for year 2016, during 2016, railway has earned total revenue of 6.6 billion while incurring recurrent expenditure of 13.4 billion. That means during the year 2016, railway had made a recurrent loss of 7.8 billion. And during that period, government has also invested 15.7 billion rupees for the development of the railway. So government is really making effort to revive the railway. So I think we also need to put our efforts together to make it happen. If you are going to consider current situation, now railway is currently having about 5% of the passenger transportation in Sri Lanka, and that's decreasing, losing market share now in 5% in passenger transportation despite annual increase in passengers. Passenger numbers are increasing, but our market share is also dropping, decreasing. But even the three-wheelers, we can also look down upon three-wheels, but three-wheel market share is about 6%, it's increasing. So we have to find out how to meet this challenge. But still, if you consider the Colombo and its suburbs, railway is still maintaining 15% of the passenger market. That's a significant, because the same way, with the expansion of the road network and arrival of road vehicles onto those roads resulted in losing that transport sector monopoly railway enjoyed. Now we got too many vehicles on the road, that is also creating opportunity for the railway. It's other way around. And if you consider the freight transportation, in 1968 under Mr. Rampala, railway enjoyed 38% of the freight transportation. Today what we are having is 0.3%, is no longer relevant. And also we got lot of valuable land asset, it not been put to proper use. And when we consider this situation, we also have to consider very low ticket price maintained by the railway due to political reason. That's also a factor about this having a huge loss, but that's a government decision, that's a political decision. So then we have to face the reality. So railway's theory of business, which was initiated century ago, may have been little by little changes may have been happened, but still remaining the same, is no longer matching the today's market reality. I want to emphasize, railway is no longer enjoying a monopoly situation. So we cannot, just by extending railway line to rural area, make development happen there. Just by extending railway line to a faraway place, we cannot expect to get business from that area. We need to find our competitive advantage. Accordingly, we have to arrange our business. Our business objectives have been clearly forgotten. One good example, in 1955 under Mr. Rampala, they fought back really hard to retain the market share. They provided so many transport service products. But today I think we are just have a mentality of just sustaining what we are doing for the people. And also today's railway, what I feel is event driven. The total organization is not having a clear objective how to proceed. So we are driven by event to event. We can have a mega project somewhere. So after that completion, we are going for another mega project. Whether those projects are clearly connected with the railway's objectives, are they really supporting the long-term survival of the railway, we are not giving enough thought. I think it's a time we need to thought about those things. And again, we got this opportunity now in the current environment. Too many road vehicles are on the road, and they are creating an opportunity for railway in urban area. Actually, when we talk about the railway and we talk about the losses made by railway, the reply usually we give is railway is there to serve the people. Profit doesn't matter. The serving people is the main purpose. So if you going to consider about the serving people, mean the resources in the society are scarce. So when the organization consume resources to serve the people, we need to give some more than what we consume, what we consume. So that's also we have to think about. So if you consider the railway, per day railway is used by 350,000 people. Usually return journey is also counted as another journey. So that means 200,000 people are using railway on average per day. With 20 million people population, that means only 1% of the population are using the railway service. But still, for the sustenance of the railway, it's a public purse is paying for the sustenance of the railway, and that's funded by tax money. So even though 1 or 2% of the population is benefiting from the railway service, especially with the cheap ticket prices, other 99% also paying for the railway. So railway need to expand its operations and increase its market share to justify its existence and to say we are really serving the people. So I think I put this one in lighter vein because any organization need to have an objective. When the organization has a clearly defined objective, the people within the organization know where they have to go. So this part I got from the book written by Lewis Carroll, is Alice in Wonderland. In this story, Alice come to a fork in the road. One road is divided into parts, and she sees this Chelsea cat in a tree. Then Alice asks Chelsea cat, Chelsea puss, which direction I ought to go? Then the cat replies, that great deal depends upon where you want to go. Then for that Alice says, it doesn't matter as long as I reach somewhere. It's somewhat different the text here. It doesn't matter as long as I reach somewhere. Then cat replies, then it doesn't matter which direction you go, if you walk long enough, you will reach somewhere. In the same way, the railway is not having any idea of the direction, so whichever direction it goes, it doesn't matter. So where it's going to end up, no one can predict. So I think turn the table other way, here you got the cat on a railway track, it's also having the same dilemma, which direction it ought to go. If you consider any business organization without any objectives, clearly defined objectives and targets, then such organizations tend to be driven by other special interest, because organization is not having any target, so there can be individual fortresses. Higher officials can have their own individual fortresses, or there can be powerful unions, or even can be political influence. So when the organization is not having an objective, those external forces will direct the organization in a way that's going to benefit them. So that situation is called the tail is wagging the dog. Here the dog is wagging the tail, just natural. But when the organization is not taking the objective, that situation can be called the tail is wagging the dog. And also the time-based reward system is also confusing. It's not contributing for a productive work situation. And also we need to understand the political situation, political and social situation. Mr. Rampala, he pioneered so many things for the railway. And for 14 years he was general manager. But after this 1970 election, he has to leave railway because culture within the political culture changed. So he couldn't cope up with the political culture. Ultimately he has to leave. So that says something about the political and social changes that happened in our country. And even on his return in 1977 as a consultant, again he has to make a hasty retreat. So all those things I think we need to think about. nothing can be taken in isolation. Things are changing. The market is changing. The political social situation is changing. So we need to understand all those things. Then we need to find solutions. And this departure of Rampala tells us that proper environment for decision making on behalf of the organization must be there. If the proper environment is not there, how hard one tries, it won't be able to achieve 100%. Of course, you have to try and maybe 50% is better, but without that proper environment, you cannot achieve the maximum. So in Sri Lanka, you have this attitude, we worship visionaries, but we conveniently neglect their wisdom. Even regarding Lord Buddha, the same situation. I think regarding Mr. B.D. Rampala, we need to learn from him. I think when you read newspapers, you see that CEO of Yahoo, CEO of those big organizations, they are getting huge sums of salaries. At the end of the year, for their performance, they are getting so many bonuses. But if you consider the railway, the decision makers are not properly rewarded. So without rewarding the decision maker, how you are going to guide an organization for the prosperity? Those private organizations, they pay for their decision makers, because decisions those managers make on behalf of the organization do matter. They do matter for the prosperity of the organization. But in any organization, they are not treating their decision makers properly. It's going to be a miracle if that organization is going to prosper. So this misguided reward system also need to be changed. I think no one is talking about this openly, but I think this should be brought into open, and they should be, decision makers should be properly rewarded, and they also should be held responsible. You can give them responsibility after rewarding them. In an organization, if you got a time-based reward system, so what will happen is the Parkinson law will come into operation. What is Parkinson law? It says work expands so as to fill the time available for its completion. It is the other side of the productivity. It's a negative productivity, because people are getting paid for the effort time they put for that work, not for the results. So that results in Parkinson's law situation. So that result in negative productivity actually. So this reward system also need to be changed. So I think now railway has to find the path, just like I told you earlier, need to find the path for success. How an organization can find the path to success? So it need to identify what are the areas it's successful. For those successful areas, they need to put more resources and more effort. In urban area transportation, even today, Sri Lanka Railway is saying a significant share. So that's the area we should put more emphasis. So we need to invest more on the success. And we need to put our most talented engineers, managers into that success area. And at the same time, we should get rid of non-performing business activities. Those are dead weight. When you carry a dead weight, difficult to concentrate on the success areas. So that means one thing is getting rid of non-performing activities, business activities, and also we need to avoid creating white elephants. And always need to have emphasis on productivity. By increasing productivity only, you can create wealth for the country and the nation. And also we need to understand the nature of mass transportation. When you put a railway line to some place, extend a railway line, you need to find out whether there is sufficient demand is there. In the railway business, for the construction of infrastructure and the maintenance of the infrastructure and the rolling stock, the huge sums of money in this money is needed. If you cannot get that money out of your revenue, that means when you extend to such areas, organization net result is organization going to lose more and more money. I think in 18 1880 or something, the railway lines reaches Naulapitiya. So Naulapitiya is a town that's created around the railway station. The railway line created that town is a kind of a lifeblood for that town. But today, if you go to Naulapitiya station, what you can see is the station and surrounding is derelict and no longer having those activities. And the township around that station is spreading, is flourishing. But the station at the middle of that town is not supporting the development activities. In a way, it's kind of a hindrance for those development activities. We need to understand the situation also. If those stations created by railway so many years back no longer flourishing at those situations, how we can expect to encourage development by extending railway line just into a rural area? So therefore, railway need to make a correct business decision. Railway need to always understand the mass transportation nature of the railway. And railway got this advantage in urban transportation. That's because too many vehicles on the road has created road congestion. So their railway got a huge competitive advantage. So what we, instead of extending railway lines to rural area, what railway need to do is create new lines to the urban town centers. One good example is, now from Maradana we can extend line through Bathramulla, that's our administrative capital, to Kottava. And by connecting Kanliman line, we can have a metro line, circular metro line. And we can even allow commuters to travel free of charge through that metro line, because that will reduce the congestion in our road network. So we have to think like, instead of, so we have to extend our railway lines where we got the demand. And also, before expanding our railway network, we have to think about utilizing our existing infrastructure. Now, I think we are talking about extending railway line from Matra to Hampantota Harbour. What about Colombo Harbour? Colombo Harbour is also connected to a railway line, 1 or 2 kilometers. According to my knowledge, that line has not been put to use for so many years. Even the railway products, they have been transported by road vehicles, even the engines, even the rails. So instead of expanding away from the town center to new areas utilizing colossal sums of money, what you have to do is we need to utilize existing infrastructure. Maybe we can start by properly connecting the existing railway line to the Colombo Harbour. Even within the Colombo Harbour, new terminals are not provided with railway lines. Even the old terminals which have been connected with railway lines are no longer used. I heard they are getting dismantled. So that kind of a scenario happening in Colombo Harbour, what's the use of expanding so other places? So we need to avoid white elephants. They can be dead weights for the railway organization, for the railway business. And when we plan our business, we need to have the end result in your mind. This is the current situation. You can see this side. So we need to target what should be the end result. Here we can see the crowded train, but we can provide more comfortable trains for the people who are willing to pay that money for their comfort. So we need to provide better quality service. That was even understood by Mr. B.B. Rampala. It's clearly stated in his forward to Centenary magazine. People no longer will come to railway because it's cheap. Because when they got the purchasing power, they demand more comfort and convenience. So we need to provide what's demanded by the potential customers. If you see the railway stations, the old railway stations, they are not in good shape. But we need to convert them something that's suitable for today's market demand. There are so many road vehicle users who like to travel by railway. If they can park their vehicle at the station, they can conveniently get into the train and go to their destination and come back again, go the backward journey using their own vehicles. The parking facility is something we need to provide as much as possible to attract people to the railway. The one good example is, if you consider even a supermarket, supermarkets where there's no parking facility, people are no longer going there. They prefer supermarkets with larger parking facilities. So railway need to think about what customer needs, and then accordingly we need to plan to achieve those end results. And even if you consider stations and rolling stock, they are also, we need to think about modernization. What is the current situation? Where we are today? And where we want to go at the end of our investment, at the end of our work. So there we need to have a clear understanding about the current situation and the end result. Only by doing that you would be able to achieve real results. So one way railway can face this challenge is by innovation. One good example is, now you can see here the hill country, all those tracks to the hill country made during the British time, made by our people, our hardworking people. You can see them clearly here, no one from abroad. They worked under supervision of British, under their supervision, using their technology and expertise. So why can't we do it today? By, you can create wealth through innovation. If you consider the recently constructed signal installation at Narayanpeta, done by railway department, it costed only 15 million. But if you consider the cost of importing signal system, it's more than 300 million. So by one, installing one station, the savings there is around 285 million. So that shows by innovation how much wealth you can create for the organization and for the country. But unfortunately, today there's a culture which says you can't do it. It's no longer fashionable to say we can do it, let's do it. It's no longer fashionable. Now, current day, it's fashionable is to get the foreign consultancy and get the foreign contractors to do your job, and also borrow money, foreign money, to do the construction. But I have never heard of any country which has developed their economy by doing that. In order to develop the country, you need to innovate, you need to believe in yourself, and then create wealth. As Kumar Mudidas said, alut alut de notanan jatiya lova nonagi. So we need to understand that advice, we need to heed that advice. As engineers, especially it's an engineers institute, I think a lot of railway engineers are here. As engineers, it's our responsibility to create wealth for the nation. When we use scarce resources, we are responsible for its proper use for the country's economy and the well-being of the citizens. If you are going to listen to the Abdul Kalam, former president of India, he says, anyone who converts a challenge into an opportunity through innovation creates wealth. He or she indeed is a leader, are you? So leaders, they create wealth through innovation. So we can even consider this introduction of color light signal to Ceylon Government Railway. It was done under Mr. Rampala. He initiated that project. And that project was given to L.M. Erickson via tender, not an unsolicited offer. And for the installation purposes, only two engineers came to Sri Lanka. I heard one engineer at a time. And they came to supervise. All the installation work was carried by local engineers, local technical officers and technical staff. That's why even today we can maintain the system. There was a smooth technology transfer. Even today we can do the changes. Unfortunately, those relays are no longer available, so finding difficult. But still, the technology transfer happened nicely. That's because all were done by local people. And I want to especially mention Mr. G.P. Dhanathunga and Mr. Oswald Silva and with others who complete this task. So I am asking you a question today. Why can't we do it today? As railway engineers, we need to think. We have done it 150 years ago, constructed all those railway lines using local labor, and they have installed signal system more than half a century ago using local people. Why can't do it today? We can do it today. That's the only way we can progress. I think there's another one good example. Our former general manager, Mr. Freyasilla, was at helm. He's a great leader. So we were able to restore this tsunami damaged railway line within 57 days. Actually, at the time of tsunami, I was at Anuradhapura. Then I was transferred from Anuradhapura to southern area to take over that division. I even didn't believe that we can do it within 57 days. But I think our general manager at that time has some other ideas. That's how we were able to do it within 57 days. So this show that railway workers, They can create marvels. They can do whatever, as long as we know how to manage them. If there is a will, there is a way. So therefore, as managers of railway, engineers, we need to understand how to unleash the railway potential. And that every railway manager need to understand. And other way around, if you consider today, those locomotives, the trains, if they are running on the roads, they are more than a half a century old, but they are still running. That's a testament to the capabilities of mechanical engineers. Then again, we can learn from the wisdom. Labor wants pride and joy in doing good work. A sense of making or doing something beautiful or useful, and to be treated with dignity and respect as a brother and sister, that's what they want. Sometimes we forget those things. Sometimes we give them salary increase, but we forget to give them recognition. I think if you go back to tsunami picture, all those people got together, they got a common aim to restore the system. They worked together as brothers and sisters. That's how they achieved those miracles. Even today we can do miracles if we can get together and plan things properly. As a service organization, the service provider cannot decide the level of service or the service products it's going to deliver to the people. That would be decided by the customers. You need to learn from the customers. Marketing is learning from the customers what they need and providing it. So we can improve upon the whatever service we are giving it today and give them a better service. By doing that, we can bring in more customers. The customers may be using their private vehicles. We can get them into railway by giving them a proper service, and we can do it only by understanding their requirements. Actually, at the starting slide, I told you that first railway line was built from Darlington to Stockton, 40 kilometer. This is the Darlington station today. It's a very beautiful station. It's still got this Victorian architecture. But you can see at the platform, the sleek electrical EMU was waiting for the passengers. While preserving our history, we need to move with new technology. So that's the lesson we can learn from Darlington today. So in order to achieve anything, you need to plan. You need to plan for the better future. In 1961, I think after Soviets, they sent that Sputnik satellite into the sky. Americans, they start getting jitters. So then under John F. Kennedy, they decide to put a man on the moon to get the supremacy in space. That was entrusted to NASA. So NASA started planning process of putting man on the moon. And there's a story. In 1961, when John F. Kennedy visited NASA, he met a janitor there. So President John F. Kennedy, he introduced himself and asked janitor, "What are you doing here?" The janitor replied, "I am helping to put a man on the moon." That happens only when organizations are having clearly defined objectives and everyone within the organization are also aligned with that objective. That's how success is created. But if the organization objectives are not clearly defined, you cannot achieve such an outcome. I think as an organization, need to walk the talk. That means talking as an end result, this will not achieve anything. In this GIF, you can see the Michael Jackson is going backward while pretending to go forward. That's a very nice dance act. His fans love it. But for a business organization, they need to go forward. When any business organization make an investment, that should result in progress. If such an investment is going to result in pulling back that organization backward instead of allowing it to go forward, we should not allow that kind of development interventions. So that's why even throughout this presentation I have been highlighting, when organization do a investment, that need to be done very, very carefully. without making it a burden for the organization. So as I said at the beginning, if I have seen further, it's by standing on the shoulders of the giant. That's Sir Isaac Newton. The similarly, we can learn from giants of railway business like Mr. D.D. Rampala in order to usher another golden era for Sri Lanka Railways. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Engineer Jayasundara, for your thoughts on less spoken words by engineers like us, especially in relation to railway, such as competition, marketing, economic feasibility, SWOT analysis, market share, business decisions, etc., by quoting from Rampala Era. And now, cordially invite Engineer Migoda to hand over a token of appreciation to Engineer Dhammika Jayasundara. Thank you. Now it's the time for the vote of thanks by Engineer Asela Patirana, Chairman, Mechanical Engineering Section Committee. So what?
Subha Sandhyavak, Mali Vanakkam, good evening to all of you. Engineer Jaivilal Migoda, immediate past president of ISL. Engineer Professor T.M. Pallevatha, President-elect of ISL. Guest Speaker Engineer Dhammika Jayasundara, Head of Signal and Telecommunication Sub-Department of Sri Lanka Railways. Past President, Vice Presidents, Council Members, Members of ISL, Former General Managers, Officers of Sri Lanka Railways, Family Members of late Engineer B.D. Rampala, and Ladies and Gentlemen. It is my great pleasure to deliver the vote of thanks on behalf of ISL for Engineer B.D. Rampala Memorial Lecture this year. First and foremost, I would like to thank Engineer Dhammika Jayasundara, Head of Signal and Telecommunication Sub-Department of Sri Lanka Railways, for accepting our invitation for today's memorial lecture. Your presentation today is so good that it makes us think in a new way. All the ideas presented are relevant for further advancement of railway. Thank you very much, sir. Secondly, on behalf of ISL, let me express my gratitude to family members of late Engineer B.D. Rampala for being with us for today's lecture. On behalf of Mechanical Engineering Sectional Committee, I would like to thank President of ISL, Engineer Professor Nilanjali Ratnayaka, immediate past President of ISL, Engineer Jaivilal Migoda, Executive Secretary, Engineer Neil Abhishekara, and ISL Secretariat, especially Ms. Ramani and Mr. Jeffrey, to make this event success. Special thanks goes to Engineer KGS Bandara and Engineer Dhammika Jayasundara for providing newspaper article for this oration. Also, special thanks goes to Engineer Arjuna Vanamperi, Vice President, Council Member of ISL, for the valuable guidance throughout this process. Finally, I am grateful to all the invitees, officers from Sri Lanka Railways, and every one of you for the be with us to participate this year Engineer B.D. Rampala Memorial Lecture. Thank you very much. Good night.